My name is Mark Hill, and I'm the producer of RaiderZ. RaiderZ is a free-to-play action monster hunting MMO. Now, that sounds like a lot, but what it means, the action gameplay, is that it focuses on real-time battles. It's not tab to target and just spam attacks until they die. It's not arbitrary damage you're taking. You have to actually use skill, use your abilities, be able to duck or dodge and roll out of the way, use all your different skill sets and everything available to you to hunt down these big monsters. Now, when I say monster hunter, I mean that even though there are some of the smaller kind of cannon fodder, you know, mobs in the game, the core of the gameplay revolves around the big monster hunt, like the big epic boss monsters. So it's all about like finding their weak spots, going on hunting parties, people with various types of abilities that all can kind of support each other and do different things like that. Now that ties in perfectly with the class system in this game, which is really unique. We call it a truly classless game. What that means is you will choose a base job at the beginning. It'll be either a berserker, sorcerer, cleric, or defender, which sort of occupy their normal MMO roles. And I'll start getting into some of it right here. For example, this character, my base job is the sorcerer, right? So I deal a lot of elemental magic, things like that, a lot of range attacks and everything, all those types of things. But I can tap through, and I can pull out the defender weapon, which is the one-handed sword and the shield, which opens me up to a whole different set of skills and abilities. Now, once you hit a certain level in the game, level 10, actually, you can start attributing your skill points that you earn to any of the other classes. So even though you might be a sorcerer, if you want to be a sorcerer that has like high DPS or can, you want to have a bunch of health so you can kind of tank these bosses, you can set it up that way. You can set up however you want. So there's a lot of diversity in the gameplay, a lot of diversity between the different characters, and a lot of different ways that a battle could take place. One of the best things about this game, and another thing of Monster Hunter style gameplay, is that if you kill these monsters, very often they'll drop something that you can use to your advantage. For example, this guy, he dropped his weapon, so I can run over it, pick it up, and then there I'm wielding the big two-handed, the big two-handed mace weapon, which would normally be reserved for the berserker class. And if you look down here, it actually changes your skill set, so you inherit the abilities of the weapon that you have equipped at the time. Now monsters, they drop various things, some weapons, as you just saw, some other health boosters. For example, I killed this shell crab right here. He dropped a piece of his shell, and if I pick it up, it's a health regen. And so my health is now regenerating. So the game is all about hunting down these monsters, killing them, taking their stuff, using it against them, and using it to empower yourself, and just continually scale up your gameplay and just get more and more powerful. Now that translates into the boss style gameplay. Now we really encourage parties in this game. There's no forced partying, but we do encourage players to find a group of people that they're comfortable playing with a diverse group of skills. So you can have one guy, you can have a guy that's doing, that's taking the tank damage, just aggroing these bosses, but still maybe dealing the elemental magic and maybe even healing his team depending on how he's set up. As we're going through this area right here, this is a fully featured MMO. It means you have all of your crafters, all of your NPCs, auction houses, guilds, parties, everything like that. And this is sort of where all this social stuff takes place in the outside world. Vast majority of the gameplay takes place in the outer worlds. Even the big monsters that we're about to see, they roam the outer world. You don't have to go to an instance. You don't have to teleport to an area. You just have to be able to hunt down, find these monsters, and initiate the combat. There are instances in the game. Very difficult, but it's where you get the best loot, you get the best gear, and also highly recommended for parties in those, because a lot of those are really, really difficult. As we're going through, you can see how detailed the environment's out, how bright it is, and this is all, I don't know if I mentioned, this game is completely free to play, right? So one thing we're trying to do with this game is blow everyone away with the amount of content and the quality of the game that you're getting for free. There won't be anything blocked off to you, players that don't want to spend, as far as levels in the game, areas they can access, things they can play as, skills they can acquire. It's all going to be totally free. Now this is one of the first bosses you'll encounter in the game. And as you can see, all the bosses are sort of products of their environment. This is a big big guardian of this area, so he's made out of stone, he swings the big column. Now, I'm slightly overpowered for where I would normally contact him in the game, but what he does do is he deals a lot of damage. So if I was to encounter this in the normal, you know, events of the game, he'd be really, really killing me as he was hitting me like this. However, what you can do is you aim at his legs, deal some damage, you'll actually knock off some of his armor right there, and you can run around, it's sitting there, and I can pick it up, and it'll fully regenerate my health. So you have to be able to actively dive out of his way, avoid the damage, deal the damage back to him, until he can drop some of that to regen your health and continue the fight. Some bosses drop items that'll allow you to craft special weapons, special high level, very powerful weapons and gear. There's a lot of diversity in the gear and the drop and the loot in the game. And players are still gonna be able to set themselves up and play, you know, specifically how they want. Go for the best gear, go for the best loot, depending on the type of character and the type of game style that they have. Each boss is really unique. They have their own unique attack patterns, their own attack styles. The coolest part is it's not just, they're not just swinging and dealing arbitrary damage. They're actually hitting you. You know, you have to get out from under his foot. There's a little AoE right there. And each boss is different. There's another boss that's like a giant frog, you know, and he has like these horn charge attacks, these big jump attacks. He'll like spit at you. There's other like flying bosses that'll swoop in and pick you up. Each one is different, and each fight is different, and they all kind of unravel differently. So that's why it's great to be able to have all these different skills available to you. You know, your skill tree. Again, this guy's not level 10 yet. If he was level 10. We would be able to start putting skill points in all these other jobs as well. So you can really set your character up. There's an infinite amount of ways that you can set your character up. And it's really specific to the player himself. So we're giving players a lot of freedom in the game, a lot of freedom for their own character. We're finding, we just wrapped up the first alpha, and one of the things the characters appreciated most was their connection to their character, because they're not railroaded along the path that the game deems they have to be on. They're truly free to set up their character however they want. So this is all very early in the game. One great thing about it is that the tutorial, the beginning of the game is not some long, grindy, boring tutorial. We put you in a boss fight like that, you'll probably encounter that guy in your very first session ever playing the game. You'll start to get new gear.
Tree guy back there too.
And yeah.
I mean, is every one of those big things its own boss? Or?
These ones are not bosses.
Oh. It looks pretty big.
Yes. They do look intimidating. Different types of enemies, are susceptible to different types of damage, deal different types of damage, offer different drops. These guys just drop like collectible loot that you can take to an NPC in the game. There's a bunny. You can kill the bunny, but I'm not going to. All right, I'll do it. There he is. Take some damage. There's just, you know, the normal monsters that run around. Some of them will attack you on sight. Some won't attack until they are provoked. This area is called Broken Mass. This is sort of the opening of the game, and this is where you get introduced to, you know, everything, all your crafting and all your quests and stuff like that. So, like we talked about, action-oriented gameplay, right? Not tab to target. You actually have to hit, be able to dive, dodge, everything like that. You have your various weapons. One thing you can do, which is cool, if you can free up the cursor, you can have up to 3 different skill trays down here, all full of skills. But what you can also do is you can bind a skill tray to a certain weapon. So right here it says link the current palette to weapon 1. If you click on that, whenever you pulled out weapon 1, this skill tray would automatically pop up. So you can change it on the fly. The game is all about being able to adapt to your surroundings, to your certain situation, which means we give you the ability to change your weapons and your skills on the fly. There's no cooldown. There's no limited amount of times you can do it. You're free to, you know, switch it up as much as you want. However, there are skills. For example, we have the staff right now. Not all skills are going to be usable while you're carrying the staff. So if you switch to a different weapon, you'll actually see that some of these are blanked out because you won't be able to use it with that weapon set. Of course, mounts in the game. You get those fairly early on. So we're trying to really engage players from the beginning of the game. We don't want them to get into this game, feel like it's just another grindy MMO, because it's not. We want to get into the action right away, start feeling feeling what it's like to be powerful and to be strong and to feel the variety from the very beginning of the game.
How big is the world?
It is very large. So this is the beginning where we are right now. And the world covers all this area. So we're right here at Broken Mast, and all this will be open when the open beta is available. Like I said, we just ended the first alpha test. It was only about 2 weeks, and this was the area that was available. It was up to level 25, gathering all the data, all the user feedback, and we'll be applying that to the closed beta, which will be coming up in the next few months. We'll open up the area even more, increase the level cap, offer players a little more, and the open beta will be even bigger and more expansive.
And when are you thinking ballpark release date?
Q4 2012. Definitely this year. As you can see, I mean, we just finished up the alpha, but it has a really high level of polish already. Right now we're focusing on the core gameplay, making sure it's fun for users, making sure they're engaged, they're not bored, making sure it's balanced, the different characters are balanced along with the bosses, because with the big, like, open world boss-heavy gameplay, there are a lot of balancing issues that come into that. So we're working on the core gameplay, making the tweaks that we need to, gathering a lot of user feedback. So it's been great. We're really excited about being able to show this pretty soon to more people in the world. All the different enemies are kind of products of their environments. We're in a kind of a beach area here, so that's why you get all these pictures.
I mean, is that something that you would be able to keep and use?
No.
It's just like a temporary...
Temporary duration, yeah. So, I will pick one up, and you'll see the... that's just a normal thing. There we go. You'll see the icon up here, and it'll count down. So this one, you only get it for 15 seconds.
That's cool, huh?
Yep. And you can really feel, if you guys were playing the game... if you were to use the staff weapon that I had, this one right here, even the one-handed sword, much faster, much lighter. But when you pick up that heavy weapon, you really feel the difference in the weight, the difference in the amount of damage that you're dealing. We want players to really feel like the physicality of the different types of weapons and different skills and major difference between the jobs, and still giving the ability to set their characters up how they want.
Those are almost like temporary little power-ups, you can use for...
Like temporary, buffs. There's also other status buffs you can get, like increase your defense, increase your HP. As you're using, for example, this one right here, if you're using some of these skills, some of these elemental skills, you can combo some of the skills together. So you saw that little pop-up right there. So if I would have hit that one, he would have done an additional attack for additional damage. Right now I have this orb floating around me, the fire orb, and it shows down here there's a temporary status buff. So the fire damage, the fire spell damage is temporarily increased. And each character has their own sort of unique buffs, unique temporary status changes like that as well. So like I said, the game focuses heavily on the big monster hunting out in the world. Roaming around with your party, finding these people, farming them for the good gear, for the good loot that you can take to the crafting NPCs to make the good weapons, the best armor, and the game just continually scales up. So it's always, you're always trying to get better, and once you finally get that piece of equipment, you look forward to the next one, and on. There's a full PvP, there's an open world PvP, but it's dual based. So you can't just go around ganking people, and you can't just be a gank constantly. You'd walk up to someone and talk to them and then challenge them to a duel, and they'd either accept or not, and then you would just start fighting right away. You don't have to go to an arena or anything like that.
And you said there's crafting?
Yes, absolutely. Crafting is one of the biggest components of the game. It's how you continually increase, you continually get bigger and better weapons and armor. There's
is
one
it self-crafting, crafter or is it more of a, you give crafters?
NPCs. Yeah.
NPCs?
Yeah, so this is the first weapon crafting NPC right here. So you'd walk up to him, and he would have all the recipes. Say you tell him you want to craft a weapon. There's all the recipes for the different items right there. It'll show you exactly what you need. You just select on one of them. You craft any one you want, even though it might not be for your job. It'll tell you the stats and everything compared to what you have equipped, and you would just start crafting it. And if you had the materials, he would go ahead and start crafting it for you right there. Now he has weapons. Right across from him is armor. Okay. So same concept, but for armor right there. And you would visit him, and he would. It's a quest I would need to pick up to activate it for him.
Okay.
But that's where you would get him. That's where you craft everything from right there.
Great.
Yeah. That's sort of the introduction to Raiders. Like I said, we just finished up an alpha. We'll be doing closed beta fairly soon within the next. We just finished up alpha. We'll be doing closed beta within the next month or two, and we are planning on a later 2012 open beta release.
Great.
Yeah. Great. Thank you.